That goes to let you know that Peter didn't have to be the only one to walk on the water. Because he didn't say, Peter, come. He just said, come.
Right.
So now here, he says this. You kick him, because I'm a kid. This is how you know that God did not kick Satan, because the Bible says, and I took a seat on earth, and I beheld his fall. So if he's on earth watching Satan fall, who kicked him? Michael.
Lord
have mercy. So Michael, so now you don't want to beef with the man that kicked you out of the spot a long time ago. And that's why you're not having you know what? I had some homeboys, Apostle. We was walking. Three guys decided they was gonna jump us. Got out the car. Come on, y'all. Let's get down with it. And I had three partners walking with me, and two of them took off. And the only person that stood there to fight with me was the shortest one out of the whole clique.
Come on, come on.
He said, man, let's go. Let's go, Amos, come on. They ain't gonna stand there and fight us. What's up? I was like, man, you ready? When I got back to the house, they were sitting there. They were sitting at the house. I said, man, y'all get out. Go ahead. Move on. Man, why you want to act like? Because out of everybody that was walking with me, this man was the only one that stayed and fought with me. And so if I had no respect for the other ones that didn't fight and told the one that did fight with me, and guess what? And the one that stayed and fought with me couldn't even really fight. But I'm still hung with him, because I'd rather hang out with the one that can't fight and got a heart than to hang out with the one that got a heart and can't fight. You get killed on the streets like that. So if I looked at that like that, then imagine how we look, that we can help Gabriel, but Michael is the only one fighting. So now that means when it's time to get down, when it's time for the spirits to get with it, your prayers and your petition ain't going up. Gabriel said, the only person who stood with me to help me fight to bring your blessing was Michael. And I would think that if he's getting ready to give you a blessing, you ought to want to fight for your own blessing. Why do you keep making Michael work for you? Because technically, Michael only is supposed to be getting ready for the greatest war of all time. All
right, man.
He's supposed to be getting ready for it. Right. He's supposed to be getting ready to get down toward the end and prepare to do whatever else God tell him to do in between. Right. That's his only job. But every time he got to run down to help Gabriel fight, when he don't have to work that hard, if your petitions go up. Okay, well, listen. Well, listen. The angel says, I've been through all of this, and the only spiritual help I received is from Michael. I suggest to you this morning, let Gabriel, listen, you ought to let Gabriel help you. Let you, you ought to let Gabriel, help Gabriel help you. Yeah, that's what I'm looking for. Thank you. Help Gabriel help you. Tell your neighbor, help Gabriel help you.
Help Gabriel help you.
Help Gabriel help you. Don't let him do it by himself. Sister, help Gabriel help you. If you want it, help Gabriel help you. And if you don't believe it ain't nothing important in helping somebody that come to help you, then what about when Paul was on the boat and the Lord said, listen, you're going to be shipwrecked, but no man will lose their life.
Right.
On this ship. And when they got to Malta, those people that was on that island started helping Paul. And Paul looked and he noticed that they started helping. And he didn't decide to be no bishop such and such.
Yeah,
man of God, they helping me. We shipwrecked. You better get here to help somebody. No, he didn't. The Bible said that Paul started helping them gather stuff. Listen, you got to help folks that's willing to help you.
Come on.
He says, listen, my first point, brothers and sisters, if you want your blessings, if you want to be released, my first point is that while you waiting on God, you got to realize he waiting on you. See, because mama, the definition, the Hebrew definition of the word wait is cover.
Uh-huh.
Q-U-V-A-H. He will cover.
Yes, talk about it.
This word weight cover would be suggested in the same weight of Isaiah 41 and 10 that says, they that wait on the Lord,
yes,
he shall renew their strength. The word Hebrew weight means to bind together.
Yes.
It means to join together,
yes,
like strings on a cord or,
yes,
a primitive,
yes,
root to bind. While you waiting on God, you and his spirit are intertwining. While you're waiting on God, you are becoming one. When he came and told Mary, she said, let it be in harmony. So what you will, harmony in the music term, would be corded together in perfect fit and perfect harmony. He said, you don't supposed to be getting further away from me while you waiting. That's the more you supposed to be praying to me while you waiting. But people don't know how to wait, because originally the word wait means to serve. And so now while you're twiddling your thumbs waiting on God, you are in direct violation, because waiting means to serve. That's why when you go to a restaurant, the ones that are serving you is called the waiters, because it is your job that while you are waiting, you're supposed to be serving. But everybody can't do that. And that's why I told the man of God back here, I said, man, you just keep on serving. The other day I said, because most people think they're important when they go to the restaurant, but the greatest one at the restaurant is the one that's serving. You know why? Because the one that's sitting down, he gets a cup of water, but the one that's serving holds the pitcher. It's like a, Listen. He said this, to bind while you're waiting on God, you're supposed to be so lost in him with praise that you don't even realize it ain't came yet. You're supposed to be so lost in him with thanksgiving, so lost in him in worship, so lost in him in relationships, not religion, so lost in him in being together and intertwining that you don't even know it ain't came yet. I'm supposed to be so lost with service on you, and while I'm serving you, I'm helping Gabriel get the answer down here. While I'm waiting on you through service, through prayer, and while in my prayer, when I pray for God for me, this time I'm not praying for my family, this time I'm gonna spend this whole prayer this evening dedicated to the safety of Gabriel. Because guess what? I got family members that said, you on your way to Vegas? Oh man, God bless you. Man, we praying for you. Hope you have a safe flight. Go and preach. I know the people of God gonna be blessed. And I'm saying that if I'm pretty sure you have people hit you on your text. And man, I wish you a safe trip. And get out there and bless the people of God. He gonna move in a mighty way. And so if you can blow my phone up with gratitude and man, be careful of that, then why we can't blow heaven's phone up and tell Gabriel, have a safe trip from coming from heaven to earth to bless the people of God. Have a safe trip on your way. All kind of hell and turbulence is in the air. And I heard the pilot say, we might hear a little turbulence, so that's all right. And so you need to tell Gabriel, I know you might hear some turbulence, but I pray for your safety, because you're going to come to earth and bless the people of God.
Yeah, man. Oh, yeah.
See, the people can call you and say, have a safe trip. Why we can't talk to Gabriel? Why we can't wish that Gabriel would have a safe trip? You got the answer to what I need. And if I know somebody is coming with the answer to my life, with a status from heaven about what I need to do, it is my mission. If I can't do nothing physical, through prayer, I make sure. Listen, everybody can't be a cherry pie. You might not be able to physically get somebody down here, but what you can do is spiritually go on your knees and pray that they have not only a safe trip, but that the people of God get what they need. It means to serve. They call it serve. The greatest ones are the ones that can serve. You waiting on God to serve you, and he's waiting on you to serve him. You waiting on God to do something for you. And he said when the 9/11 came, they had signs everywhere that we got on the good foot then, because then we were saying, God bless America. But when 9/11 came, they had signs that said, America bless God. Yeah. This means that and listen, I was waiting on a friend one time, Apostle. He said, I'm on my way. I'm 10 minutes away. Matter of fact, I use it as a prime example. Prime example. The other day, and I was waiting on you to come, and I said, okay, Apostle said he coming. I said, so I'm doing all of this. Then all of a sudden, you said, the man of God coming to pick you up. I said, come to pick you up. I said, okay. I was doing all kind of stuff. Trying to get some stuff. And then all of a sudden, you said, he outside. I said, man. Oh, man. I said, he here already? But then, this morning, you said, I'll be there, man of God. I said, okay. And I'm sitting there. I got my worship music on. I'm just, seemed like 10, 15, 20 minutes passed. What Pastor said, he gonna come. Next thing you know, I got up, I said, well, you know what, he gonna be a minute. So let me get up and start doing, as soon as I got up and started doing this, I got a call from the front desk that said, somebody here for you. I said, I knew Apostle was gonna do that. And so I got ready to come outside. What am I trying to say? I'm trying to say the other day, I found myself busy and my ride was outside. Today I was sitting around and it seemed like it took forever. Might I suggest to you the only reason why it seemed like your blessing is taking forever because you ain't doing nothing.
Come on.
Because if you find yourself busy, you'll look around and discover, man, God, you did a quick work. But I discovered it seemed that God is taking forever when you take it forever. So now, if you take forever to bless God, he's going to take forever to bless you.
Come on.
You patty cake God, he's going to patty cake you. Right. You can't ask God for no $10,000 worth of blessing and you give him a 10-cent hand clap. But look, that's even exchange ain't highway robbery.
Come on.
And how many of us come to God with 1,000 requests and all he say is, bless me? Adam, I don't understand why we are what we are. I'm giving you dominion. I'm giving you everything. You can name the animal. You go, all of this is your dominion. All I ask is for one thing. Don't touch that tree. That's all I'm asking for. That's all I'm asking. You got dominion. I don't need to be down here running you. You name them. You come back and tell me what you name them. And Adam, what's that? Well, I named that a zebra. It's a zebra then. Adam, what's that? I named that a lion. It's a lion then. Adam, that's you got it. And that's all I ask you is that you do. But somewhere along the line, sin brought about when it went from dependence to independence. So you keep in mind when they say Happy Independence Day, that's the day we messed up.
It's
the day we messed up because that means it went from dependence on God to independence of yourself. And now everywhere around the world, people are excited to say, I'm independent. That means they got their own thing. They doing their own thing. They survive, I'm independent. I don't need nobody, baby. And that started from Adam and Eve when they decided they didn't need him no more. Listen. How deeper would it be in the spirit realm that instead of asking for God for something for 3 weeks, you prayed for Gabriel's safe trip?
Come on.
How awesome would you be in the spirit instead of bugging God for 21 days, you laid on your face rejoicing that it was already done?
All right.
How about instead of bugging God for 504 hours, you start thanking God that he already fixed it? How about instead of bugging God for 30,240 minutes, I'm only giving you what lies in 21 days, that you would begin to petition God? How deep in the spirit would you be that instead of bugging God for 1,814,400 seconds, that you would pray to Gabriel, bring your answer down here that God already said it. I answered it the first day you asked me. That means you spent 20 additional days doing stuff that didn't even matter. Here the beans to hit it.
Hello.
Come on,
God.
Come on.
be if you stop bugging God and just start praying that, listen, nations are coming together. This is an atmosphere, because all of this is for nations and for people to come together and start rerouting, retwisting, and redoing what God put together.
That's right.
And in the beginning, he made man and woman. He made Adam and Eve. But the world today can tell you Adam and Steve is okay.
Come on.
And Eve and Ebony is all right. You have people now in Canada, they sign a resume, and on that resume, it has male, female, or non-binary. And what non-binary means is, I have the right to tell you that I'm male and female. That's what they got in Canada. They got that going on right now. They have a computer that's 8 stories tall called the Beast.
Yes.
In certain places, where they play soccer in, they have the season passes, where if you want a season pass, they're doing this now, Apostle. For a season pass to a soccer game, I want to say it's in Istanbul, but the season to the soccer games, they put a chip in your arm. And if you a season ticket holder, not like a regular purchaser, but if you a season ticket holder, they got a space where you can go, where you can show up. If you're a season ticket holder, all you can do is come in and scan your arm and keep going. That's for the season ticket holders. And you mean to tell me that hell is worth it over a soccer game? He said this here. Okay, let me move on. Point 2 on how can I get my blessings here. First of all, I understand that while I'm waiting on God, God waiting on me. And then you got to understand this. Here's the deal. Here's point 2 on how you can get it. Instead of watching your dance, watch your stance. Because churches all around the world, even now, are probably up there giving. Right now, they shouting out. They shouting everywhere, but they gonna leave right out of the church without an answer to their problems. You can have a dance all day. You can go get new shoes. You can go get you some New Yorkers. But if my New Yorkers is dancing all over the carpet and I don't have enough faith to reach New York, I got a problem.
That's right.
Yeah, what good is red bottoms with a black heart? You got a problem. You got a problem. You got a problem. He said this here. So many churches are ready for a praise break, but don't know how to throw no hands. They, when you run from a fight, you are a wimp in the natural. So what make you think you're not a wimp in the spirit?
That's right.
When you're running from a fight. The problem is, we gonna expose how many gangsters in church there was really nobodies in the street.
Come on, man.
So you wait to get the church to look hard. But if a person needs your resume, they'll find out you the one getting beat up while you coming to church talking about so-and-so better not say another thing to me. You wouldn't bust a grape in a fruit fight. Go pray for her and sit down. You can't fight.
Yeah.
You can't fight. You can't fight. Like Apostle said, go tell it to Shorty. I'm too tall for that one. You can't fight. You can't fight. He said, so when you dance, your dancing ain't helping Gabriel. Your stance is what's gonna help Gabriel. You dancing in church, that's not helping Gabriel, but it's the willingness and the dedication and the litigated nerve to say that while I'm waiting on God, I am gonna bombard atmospheres, I'm gonna charge atmospheres, I am gonna make sure that Gabriel gets my message to me, because guess what? He's coming down here in bundles. Gabriel ain't gotta take no trip back and forth. So this lets me know that while I'm praying to get my answer, I'm really praying for somebody else. It's because he's coming in bundles.
Come on.
Yeah. I'm finna drop. He's coming like Santa Claus. I'm finna drop yours off. I'm dropping yours off. Overseer Will, I brought this for you. Apostle, I brought this one for you. Osmosis, I brought this one for you. Jerry, I brought this one for you. And when I get through dropping out, man of God, I brought this one for you. I brought this one for you. So now that y'all prayed, all it took is for a few people to pray. I just needed to slip through.
So when you can get on your knees for you, I thank you because now I pray for you, you pray for me. He coming in bundles. So now we both can pray. That's cool. I used to have some partners and I say, man, where y'all going to the store? They say, yeah, we getting ready to go to the store. And I say, well, man, here go my money. And even though I didn't go to the store, I was excited because although I didn't go to the store, I knew something was coming back for me.
Come on.
Yeah, so thank you, Gabriel, for making a store run for your boy. Yeah. See, it's all right to have a dance if you're going to put a stance on it.
That's right.
R.I.P. Muhammad Ali used to be told he danced around the ring too much. They say, Muhammad, you dancing too much. You dancing. He say, I float like a butterfly. I sting like a bee. But he could never sting like a bee if he didn't know how to float like a butterfly. Me floating like a butterfly is what got me open to sting you like a bee. Because a boxer knows that the most important part of boxing is not your fists, it's your legs. Lord have mercy. Listen, the most important part of prayer is not that you can put your hands together like this. It's your position. Because if you put your hands together like this, then 9 times out of 10, you are the order if you really want to get to God. Because if you really trying to reach him, then you should really be like this.
Amen. Come on.
All right. Come on. And I don't need much stove. I just can't lay on the floor, but you get my drift. The different stance in boxing are orthodox and southpaw. The orthodox stance of boxing would have your left leg in front of you. And then the southpaw stance of boxing, you would just turn like this. Either way, the boxer knew that his strongest hand had to be behind him. Oh, good God Almighty. The strongest part of your hand is the one that's in the back of you, because boxers know that your power punch is the one that got to be in back of you so that you can draw all with it. And so you ought to stop getting mad when it seems like you last place in ministry. It's a good indication that if the church is a body, you being last place is a good indication you might be God's power hand, because that hand got to be in the back. So when you come around full force, you gonna knock something loose. I can stand here and jab you all day, but it's when I bring that thing around, it's gonna make you think twice about walking up on me. And so that's what he said. He said, while you're learning to dance, you gotta learn what it's gonna take to knock the Prince of Persia out so you can get what you need. I'm not worried about my dance, that's all fine, but if I'm gonna dance, let me be dancing around my enemy so I can plant him one when he least suspected. That's it, what we doing, and we can help Gabriel. He said, don't worry about your dance. What about your stance? It's my leg work is just as important as my hands. Your strongest hand is in the back of you. Stop crying. The strongest are in the back to deliver a hard strike. And I don't mind taking a back seat because only God impressed me. Listen, I don't mind being last to you. Because my punch, when I do come up, it's gone. People can preach 5 times in a day with no anointing, and you can preach 1 time with the anointing of God, and it'll break chains off of folks. Folks can fly all over the world and sing Woman of God 5 and 6 times. I'm a musician. I've had 3 and 4 concerts in 1 time, and folks can sing all over the world with no anointing, and it's just a gig. And then you can show up and sing 1 song with the anointing, and folks can't figure out why they can't stop crying. It's the anointing that destroys the yokes. Anything else other than the anointing is a talent.
Come on, Jesus.
And if you want a talent, go to the club and karaoke if you want to display your talent. But when you get here in church, it's the anointing. You ain't got time to practice. So woman of God, keep singing, keep ministering. Because I've learned as a young person, I'm wasting God's time preaching, spending 15, 20 minutes explaining how I'm young and I still can preach. I don't have time for that. You wasted your time to come here to hear youngster. You're going to get a word or go home.
That's right. That's
Who get mad at me, get mad at God and cherry pie. They pay for it. Listen. Stop crying because you feel last. Stop crying because you in ministry and it seems you ain't getting all together. And it's a stop crying because of that. You got to realize something. That if God is putting you on the backside of the mountain, if God is taking a while to expose you, if God is setting you, he's setting you up because he's setting you up for John chapter 2 where they all came in there and the governor said when he tasted the wine, he said, truly, you saved the best for last. But they served the good stuff. They was already drunk. What does this let me know? This lets me know I don't care how much of the church is getting drunk off of false prophets, how much they get drunk off of false word and warmed over word, how much they get drunk off of half anointed people. When God bring you from the back to the front, when God anoint your lips, when God give you strength, and when he finally make way for you to open up your mouth, people are going to know why he's been saving you. Because even folks that are drunk off of foolishness don't realize you're still good tasting wine. That's why I don't worry about it, Apostle. That's why I don't worry about it. Who can get up here with this and this and this and this and this and this and that? I don't have to say one word of Hebrew, no word of Greek, but can get up here with the power of God.
And
folks all over the world would never be the same. Because why? It's the anointing. Listen, the translation in the Bible I was reading the other day, it says, but the Prince of Persia withstood me for 1 and 20 days. And I'm going to wait my seat. 1 and 20 days. I said, Lord, how come they just didn't say 21 days? Why they have to say 1 and 20? It's like, what besides, that's how they talked, 70. That's 70. But it revelated to me, I suppose, that the reason why he had to say 1 and 20, he said, because I wanted to let you know that one was significant to the day I answered your prayers. The other 20 days was just 20 days. And he said 1 and 20 days did the Prince of Persia hold you up. So what he's saying is, I answered you the first time, but the end 20 days was all about your position and what you need to be doing. It is the same contrast as Zacharias and Elizabeth been waiting all of this time to have a baby. And the angel comes to Zacharias and says, today, Zacharias, the Lord has heard your prayer. Prayer, singular, but he's an old man. Pretty sure he prayed more than one time. I'm pretty sure he tried more than one time. So why would the angel say prayer? This lets me know that, man, the Lord heard you the first time. So stop crying about stuff. He gave you your hearing. You think he can hear? You think he can hear? Think he's void of understanding? He told you and all you're getting, you get understanding. You think he don't understand? So why do you keep on praying to God like he can't hear you? And why do you keep asking for the same thing like he can't hear you? Lord, touch my body. Now, what you need to be praying from then on is, I'm not waiting on it. What you need to be praying from then on is, Lord, protect Gabriel so that my healing can get here on time and safe.
Come on now.
Because you ought to be tired of walking around aching and pain, and when you know your healing is in the atmosphere. It left heaven a long time ago.
That's right.
Yes. Oh, Lord, have mercy. That's right. Listen, I'm flattered about the extra 20 days, Daniel, but I answered you on day one. You should have took those 20 days and prayed for Gabriel. You did the right thing. You fasted. You prayed. But no prayer for the one bringing the message.
That's right.
You. He says this. A lot of times it's not about changing your prayer. It's about changing your strategy. A boxer can fight. The strategy. Moving your legs. Putting your power hand behind your footwork. When you do that, then Gabriel won't have to say, and the only person who helped me withstand was Michael.
That's right.
You don't have to be accused of not helping Gabriel when you start doing this thing right.
Amen.
And my third point, I'm going to wait at my seat. I got to get up out of here. At least I bore you too long. My third point, and I'm gone, is this. After you realize that God is waiting on you, and not only after you realize that God is waiting on you, after you watch it dance,
watch your stance too. Then thirdly, you got to understand something, and I'm about to say something, and I promise you hear me by the Spirit of God. Because I'm going in the verse where Daniel says, then again, the one having the likeness of man, verse 18, and strengthened me, and he said, O man greatly beloved, fear not. Peace be to you. Be strong. Yes, be strong. So when he spoke to me, I was strengthened. And I said, let my heart speak, for you have strengthened me. My brothers and sisters, listen, I want to wait in my seat, and I promise you, and for three of you that would get excited about what I'm about to say, then guess what? Your answer is about to come more faster than you realized it. For four people that can get excited about what I'm about to say, and I'm about to say this, that on your mission, just like Daniel, the next touch is about to give you some strength. The next touch from God is about to give you strength to fight. You've been irritated, you've been frustrated, you've been contemplating about not coming to church. Why I gotta do all this? Why I gotta do all that? It just ain't worth it. But I promise you, just like Daniel, the next touch from God is about to give you strength to keep on going. You can testify more of the devil on your trail before you testify him giving you hell. The church has become weakened. It seems as though there is no strength. It seems as though there is no hope. It seems as though there is no life. But I come to tell you that the next touch from God is going to give you strength. The next touch from God is about to heal your bones. The next from the Holy Ghost. My praise will be like a shotgun for the next 21 days because there is something I need to receive out of the atmosphere. My strategy will tear your kingdom down for the next 504 hours because I feel that there is a release from the atmosphere. Yes, for the next 30,240 minutes, I'm going to help Gabriel get all that God has for me. The next touch is going to strengthen you. I know you've been tired, but the next touch is about to strengthen your bones. I know you've been weary, but the next touch is about to bring you out. Tell your neighbor, the next touch is about to strengthen you. You keep on saying, I'm coming to God's army, and he ain't moved yet. Coming to church again. Why it seems we have to do this? Going to church all week. I'm here now. And it seems like some folks don't appreciate me. Seems like some folks don't care. But the next touch, Lord, look at your name. I got to get out of here. For the next 1,814,400 seconds, I need you to grab you a neighbor by the hand. And I'm on the way to my seat. I'll be at you good evening from Houston. And thank you for having me all the way in Las Vegas, Nevada. It's a pleasure to come talk about a Savior in CNC. But I tell you one thing, for the next 504 minutes of your life, you need to bombard heaven with a praise. Somebody just begin to open up your mouth. Begin to open up your mouth. Begin to open up your mouth and say, I'm not going to stop. I'm looking for a touch for the next 21 days. I am looking for a touch for the next 504 minutes. I'm looking for a touch. shake that neighbor's hand like you're shaking off last year's frustration. Shake that neighbor's hand like you're shaking off last year's heartache. Shake that neighbor's hand like you're shaking off last year's frustration. And tell them the next touch, God! Come on, son, the next touch. The next touch. Come on, begin to open up your mouth. Need everybody to open up their mouth. Because he know Gabriel got some help. I need for you for the next 21 days to say, Lord, begin to open up your mouth. Let these hear you. Open up your mouth. Shake the roof off this place and say, I'm not going to just be without my answer. I'm not just going to be without an answer. I'm tired of being faithful and ain't nothing happening. I'm tired of giving my money.
God to make a way for you, and it's here. You're asking for God to send in the loved one. to you. You got to open up your heart.
Thanks.